Hi, everyone. Thanks again for coming. I saw that a few more people were logging in and probably setting up their audio right now. So, and thank you to those folks that wrote to me to tell me that they could hear me and they could see my screen. That's always reassuring. I'm here today. My name is Meredith Price, and I'm the product manager for Imaris. And I'm here today to give you an introduction to the newest release of Imaris. This release came out last week, and so if you are a current customer, you are able to go to our customer portal to download an installer for 9.2 and to update your license and start using it. And so hopefully some of you that are here today have had a chance to check out the release notes and to work with this new version of Imaris. At the same time, I'm sure there's some of you that are interested in seeing what's new and you might want to try it out. So I'll put the link up at the end of the presentation, but I also just want to say that you can go to bitplane.com or imaris.com, and from there you're able to request a link to be able to work with a demo version of Imaris. And so we're happy to work with you to get you started with that. So if you're interested, definitely reach out to us and we'll take care of you. So my goal for today is that I will review the features that are new to version 9.2 and also some other related features to give you a better background of Imaris. Someone does have an audio problem, so we should try and help them. Okay. And then as I'm going through and I'm going to go through and introduce some of these features from 9.2, but then I'm also going to go into the software and actually show you some of these features as well. So it's going to be split between working within PowerPoint and then moving on into Imaris. And I wanted to say that your microphones are muted automatically. But I can imagine that you'll have some questions. If you go ahead and type those into the chat box, then I'll be able to see them later towards the end of the presentation, and I'll go through those and answer those for you where I can. Okay. So when I take a step back and think about Imaris 9.2, it really is the step forward in our ability to analyze and work with larger and larger images as microscopes continue to push the limit of what is possible. So this release has improvements aimed at allowing you to count and track cells and to do this in very large images. And so these improvements were made possible by increasing the rendering and calculation speed for both our spot and tracking tools. And this is, and these improvements are found within the context of our larger family of software. So our Imaris family of software consists of the file converter, as well as Imaris Stitcher, and then Imaris proper, as I say. So Imaris file converter is the beginning of our workflow where you can take your microscopy files and then convert those into Imaris files. That allows them to be visualized and loaded within Imaris very quickly. And that file conversion is optimized for working with large images, and it's able to batch process those. And then we also have Imaris Stitcher, which allows you to align and then fuse images that have been acquired as tiles, and then to export out one single Imaris file from that. And again, Imaris Stitcher is made with the idea that it will be working with large data. And so that could mean many, many tiles that need to be aligned and then fused together. Or it can mean Or it can mean working with relatively few tiles, but they're very big files, and having to stitch those together. And in both cases, you'll export out those images as Imaris files, and then again, be able to visualize them and work with them very quickly within the Imaris software. So up until now, I've been saying very large images over and over again. And so what does very large mean? And I used to say it can, and I still believe this, it means different things to different people. So in this time lapse from a light sheet microscope of a zebrafish embryo, this is a time lapse that is about 2 terabytes in size. And so that is certainly a large image, and many people would consider that large. But very large can also just simply mean that it's an image that's bigger than the amount of RAM on your system. And so in these cases where your images are larger than the amount of RAM you have on your system, you will see a significant speed increase when using spots and using our tracking algorithms, and as well as some other places that I'll be talking about for previous improvements in Imaris. But these improvements for 9.2, those aren't the only improvements where Imaris is optimized for visualizing and analyzing large images. In 2005, Imaris addressed volume rendering so that your very large original images can be visualized dynamically in 3D. And by dynamically, what I mean is that the optimal resolution of the image is shown on your screen depending on the zoom level of the image, as well as depending on hardware factors such as the screen resolution and the graphics card memory. So this dynamic rendering of the image resolutions is performed in a blockwise manner, such that the portions of the image closer to the camera are rendered at a higher resolution than those that are farther away. And so this image right here is to show you how an image can be broken up into blocks, and blocks of differing sizes. And so your larger blocks are at a lower resolution, whereas your smaller blocks, those that are in blue or outlined in slicers that are blue, are at a much higher resolution. So this means that the resolutions of the blocks are adjusted also as you rotate and zoom into your image, and this provides you the best possible resolution at all times. And so we have a video over here where the blocks are colored differently. So you can see as you zoom in to this section of a kidney that that these blocks change color, and that's because we're getting higher and higher resolution blocks as we zoom in, and now we're zooming out, and so the blocks are bigger and at lower resolution. And again, this is a dynamic way of interacting with your image so that at any time you're seeing the best possible resolution based on, again, your graphics card, your screen resolution, and your image. So it's made possible because we use this Imaris file format. It's a highly lossless compressed file. It, again, uses this multi-resolution image pyramid, as I mentioned before, and then the actual rendering is multi-threaded, and there's decompression happening, or there's multi-threaded of the rendering, decompression, and loading to make this as quick as possible, as well as some data caching, and it allows you to be able to rotate and pan very quickly and smoothly within Imaris. So this is how you are able to look at your original images that are much larger than the RAM on your system. But what about analyzing those images? And so with Imaris 9.0, a release that we put out last summer, our team turned their attention to surfaces. And so surfaces are these 3D solid models representing signals within your image. And these models allow you to report things like counts of objects or intensities, as well as morphological measurements. And those objects in your image that the surfaces are representing can be things like organelles and cells or larger objects such as tissues or whole organs like you're seeing here. So you're seeing a brain whose vasculature was imaged using light sheet microscopy, and this 72 gigabyte image was, we used surfaces to reconstruct the brain, and we were also able to reconstruct the vasculature as well, and so you see that in purple. Okay, so to improve our surfaces, our development team took that same rendering approach as the one established with volume rendering. And with this technology, again, you can smoothly render your surfaces from extremely large images. And again, it's based on the same foundation of using a multi-resolution format with a blockwise layout, making sure that we are loading onto the graphics card the appropriate resolution levels of that surface rendering to match the screen resolution and to fit into the graphics card's RAM, and then using data caching and multi-threading to make the make your interaction and the rendering speed as smooth and as fast as possible. Okay. And so what we see as a result, if we look at what the rendering speeds were previous to version 9.0 when this tool was released, is that as you went higher and higher in image size and created surfaces from those images, is that you started to see frame rates or frames per second decrease. And so you weren't able to rotate and interact with your surfaces very quickly. But as soon as we switched over to Imaris 9.0, it doesn't depend on how up to about many hundreds of gigabytes. It doesn't matter the size of your image that your surface was created from. You are able to maintain a rendering rate of frames per second of 300. So you're seeing this vast improvement in the interactivity. But to get to the point where you have those surfaces, you have to calculate them. And so you need to more quickly be able to generate those surfaces and calculate those. And this is built upon blockwise calculations. So it allows Imaris to work on very large images when you have little RAM, or what is relatively little RAM in comparison to the size of your images. And so it allows you to work with these very big images. And again, it's multi-threaded to make this as fast as possible. What this means for you on a daily basis as you're working in the lab is it means that you don't have to work with regions of interest. So you don't have to settle for only working on a portion of your image. You can work on the entire image all at once. And also, you don't have to downsample your image and only work with a lower res version of your image to be able to get these results out of our surfaces tool. So again, you're able to work with these very large images and to have fast rendering and to have fast processing, and you don't have to settle for working with just portions of the image. So with version 9.2, again, it was released last week, our development team turned their attention to the spots and tracking tools within Imaris. So the spots tool is commonly used to detect things like vesicles or nuclei, cells, and a variety of other round or spherical-like objects. It then reports counts and intensities, as well as spatial positions for those detected objects. And you can, spots is also commonly used when you are working with time-lapse images to perform the tracking of those objects as well. And so now with Imaris 9.2, you can use these tools to analyze and visualize spots and then their motion in your terabyte size images, including in very long time lapses. Okay. So at this point, I'm probably sounding like a broken record because, again, we are mentioning that we have fast rendering of spots and fast rendering of tracks. These These rendering improvements also allow you to have fast file opening, and so that's true for the volume rendering, it's true for the surface rendering, and again, it's true for the spots and track renderings available in 9.2. And then also, another broken record, we're doing the processing, and we're able to improve the processing or the speed of processing for spots because we're doing the calculations in a blockwise manner, and it's and again, you're able to have work with a situation where you have relatively little RAM and still work with big images. On top of this, we did address our tracking algorithms and made performance improvements to those so that it could especially, the algorithms could especially deal with the situations where you have many objects per time point. And so you can see a case of this in this Drosophila embryo. It was imaged on a light sheet microscope at Genelia Research Campus by Katie McDowell. And there are many thousands of cells at this stage. And what it adds up to is that we have a 2 terabyte file here, and there's a total about 8.6 million spots. And I can play through this. What you can see is that we're just looking at the nuclei positions with our red spots here, and we can see the tracks, which are color-coded. And we can now see, if you know Drosophila development, that you get germ band elongate or germ band retraction, sorry, and you can actually see a little bit of segmentation there happening as well, the developmental type of segmentation. And so soon we'll actually get to the point. Katie got really far with this embryo because you can see that its muscles are starting to work and it started to twitch a little bit. So what's really cool is that now this entire data set can be analyzed, and it can be analyzed in a relatively short period of time. And again, you don't have to settle for working on just a region of interest or a portion of the data set. within this entire release, there are other places where we made speed improvements that will help you when you're analyzing your files, and it will make your entire workflow a lot faster. And so one of those places is probably well known to existing customers, and but for also new customers, I'm sure you can imagine that when you are working with your files and you're using Imaris to detect cells or nuclei or vesicles within your image, that there are times when you need to perform some editing. And so in that case, you would go to our edit tab where you have the ability to add and delete spots. And because of some changes in the way that we're handling our statistics, our spot statistics, we have smarter handling of that. And so it makes the adding and deleting of spots much faster. And this is something that for smaller images, you likely haven't noticed, but for larger images, that you'll see a significant improvement there. And the second place where you'll see an incredible speed improvement is on the statistics tab. And so I'm just showing you an image here, a little snapshot from Imaris, which shows a statistic tab. And this is where Imaris presents you tables where you can pick the measurement that you're interested in, and it's listing the values, in this case position, for each of the spots. It's listing those values for everything that's visible in that, everything that's visible at that given time point. This was from a time-lapse image. And so if we're thinking about going back to that, to the image I had on the previous slide where we have millions of spots through the entire time-lapse, there's a ton of information that needs to be organized within these tables. And through the reworking of this tab, now these tables are popping up much more quickly and they're much more interactive. And so the responsiveness here is much faster. So I think that'll make a lot of people really happy as well. And so then the third aim for improving the speed within your workflow was to take a look at tracks. And so at this point, I'm going to move over to Imaris. What I will say as I'm starting to do that is that we're going, we focused specifically on the track edit tab. And okay, so this is a 150 gigabyte time-lapse image. This is that zebrafish embryo from before. It's going to take just a couple more seconds to load up. And previous to the webinar, I had gone in and done some tracking of this embryo. So the nuclei were labeled here. And I'm just going to turn on our feature called Dragon Tails so we have a little bit clearer view of what's going on. And then I'm going to go to the Track Edit tab. Okay, so if I play through time, I'm going to zoom in a little bit here. I'm going to play through time. And what you're seeing are all of the spots with a little tail. It's just a portion of the track that's following behind it. So it's only a few time points behind it. And then, so we're seeing that on the right-hand side within our 3D space. But then over here on the left-hand side, I'm showing the track edit tab. And this tab has been reworked a little bit to make your life easier when you're going in and you're doing editing. So let me, there's a particular time point that I'm fond of. Okay. Okay, so I'm looking at just some of these cells that are at the edge and watching them, and you can imagine a situation where you want to go in here and you want to clean up the automatic tracking that took place that Imaris did within the wizard, creating these spots and these tracks. And so I know that if I look at this spot right here, and if I go from time point to time point, I see a break in my track. So this spot right here at this time point is not connected to that track. You can see that more clearly now. So what I want to do at this point is I want to use Imaris and the track edit tab to connect these two tracks together. So I'm going to first switch to the select mode, and I'm going to select this track right here. And then I'm going to click on this button called Rebuild Around Selection. So this is one of the bigger changes to the track edit tab, and what it does is that it creates a view within the track editor. So this is a graph where you're seeing your tracks and your individual spots. It's these balls, and you have you have your time points listed on the left-hand side. It creates this graph, but now because I've by default I have focus tracks checked on. Now, instead of seeing the 23,925 tracks that make up this entire data set, instead I'm just seeing 15 of those. And those 15 that I'm visualizing right now within this window are determined or were picked because of their proximity to the track that I selected. So by selecting this track and then rebuilding around selection, I am just finding those 14 other tracks that are nearby. And in fact, if I then hold down Control and click on this track right here, that guy, yep, that spot, becomes selected and highlighted because it is the closest one. It is that neighbor. And so by eye, I know that I should connect these, so I can go and do that now. And that's the second place where we made some changes within this track edit tab. And so what we changed was that previously we had two buttons, a connect and a disconnect button, and now we have three. So first, connect, that didn't really change, except for now instead of saying connect, it has a graphic to describe what's happening. You can see that if I hover over it, it will say connect. And also what's changed is how I can interact. So now it's much easier to just select two tracks and connect those, or to select a series of points and connect those through time into one single track. So that should be much easier for everyone out there doing lots of track editing or working on track editing. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. And so that's going to get updated, and we'll see that connect in a second. The other thing that we can do within these images is we can perform, we can disconnect some of these objects. So what I can say is, oh, what if I just made a mistake and I want to disconnect it? Well, there's two different ways of disconnecting, and hopefully these graphics help you understand that. So the first one is more of a split. And so what it would do, or what it does, is that it splits your track into two separate tracks. And it does that at the time point that you've currently selected. So this track is selected, and this time point 68, is what we're visualizing right now, or frame 68. And so the way that this button works is that it would first disconnect the edge, or the connection that's previous to the time point, so between 67 and 68. So I can do that now. And we'll see those disconnect. Okay, and then if I hit it again, now because there's no previous connection, it will disconnect the connection after this time point. So it takes a couple of seconds here because I'm working with a data set with 24,000 tracks. When you have a more realistic or a more normal number of tracks, it's much faster, and it's instantaneous in its responsiveness. This last button, I'm not going to click right now, but what it will do is that for the tracks that are selected, it will disconnect those tracks into individual objects. So that means that all of the connections will be severed. I have nicknamed this obliterate because it really does just chop up your track so there's nothing left. Hopefully by putting this, I know it's a useful tool, but it's one that's not used as often. And hopefully by putting this as a separate button, people don't accidentally obliterate their tracks too often. Let's see. One other thing that I do want to say about these buttons is that the connect track also has a keyboard shortcut associated with it. So that's just the keyboard, the letter C, and then disconnect has one as well, and so that's the letter D. So hopefully that makes things a lot faster and easier for you as well. Okay, let's see some other things that I want to show you. I am going to actually close down this image and go to another one. Do that in a second. I want to play through another embryo where, so here I have a C. elegans embryo. I can probably adjust the display a little bit so you can see the outline of the embryo it's a rather early embryo, and we're identifying the nuclei with a GFP signal. And so I have gone through this data set, and it's been tracked. And it's showing cell divisions, and those are tracked as well. And I want to use this data set to show you some of the new options we have for dragontails. And so I mentioned dragontails before, but I did just a quick overview of that. Now within the settings tab, you can see track display. And often by default, Dragontail will be on. And again, what it means is that only the last 1,035 seconds of the track are being shown. And so as you move through time, parts of the track disappear and new ones appear as they become older. So now it's easier to adjust the length of your Dragontails, and also you're able to not only show past portions of your track, but also future portions of your track. So instead of showing everything in the past, I could switch that. And now I'm seeing where, now as I move through time, I'm seeing where the cell will go. I'm seeing the future track instead of where it has been. So it gives you some extra flexibility there. The other thing that's really nice about having this flexibility and having this faster track rendering is that it gives you the ability to render your tracks such that they you're able to show the entire track as it builds up through time. And so that's something that's new to this version of Imaris as well. Before, it was only limited to about 40 frames worth, and now it can be the entire movie. So you can play around with that too. Okay. So over on the right-hand side, I'm going to switch gears a little bit. Over on the right-hand side, we have a set of features that's called labels. And hopefully, if you're a current Imaris user, you've been able to play around with this a little bit. And if you're not an Imaris user now, I think this is one of those extra features in Imaris that really is able to take some of your analysis and even some of your editing too to the next level and really help you and speed up your workflow. So the way that labels works, or the idea behind labels, is that I can go into my image. And I can, let me change this back. Okay. And I can say, okay, at the beginning of this time lapse, I have 8 cells. So, and I want to know by the end of the tracking, because these cells are dividing and this embryo is developing, I want to know where the daughter cells, where they end up, and I want to understand that based on their mother cell. So to do that, what you can do is you can go in and you can create a new label group. So let's say worm mother cells. So I have a new group, and then I can go in and add some labels. So I'll just do a few of these. So I'll say cell one, and I can select this cell right here, double click on cell one, and now it's labeled. It will be green. So Imaris will assign it this name, and also the color is randomly assigned, but I can go in and edit that if I want to. And because the base color is green, I'm going to change this now. So let's make that more of a cyan. Okay. And then I can proceed by selecting another cell, adding a label to it. It is refusing to leave the green color because cell two is now green. Okay, move on to cell three, pink. Thank you. Okay, and one last cell four. Okay, so now I've labeled these, and I'm going to turn off the volume just so we can see those a little bit more easily. And I'm going to go to the color tab over here. And I'm going to change the base color for the other spots over, or for the other cells over to gray. So now we can see we have 4 cells that I haven't labeled, basically just for speed. And then I have 4 cells on the left-hand side that I have labeled. And what's nice is that now through time, because I've tracked, I can see where, let's see, that is cell 2. I can see where the descendants or the daughter cells from cell 2, I can see where they end up. Now, at this point, you might say, oh, there's a lot going on, and that is true. And so to get around that problem, what I can do is within the color tab, I can go in and I can say I only want to show labeled objects, and I just need to do that for both points. Oh, hopefully you guys can still see me. I can do that for both points and for tracks. And so now you're only seeing those cells and their tracks that have been labeled. I can turn these on and off if I want to. And again, I can change the colors or change the names if I need to. So that's for visualization, and that can help you when you're making movies and presentations. But what it can also do is it can help you when you're going in and you are working with your measurements or your statistics. So I'm going to go back to this statistics tab that I talked about before, and then go to detailed. And the reason I'm doing that, let's go to something kind of interesting. So let's go to position. The reason that I'm doing that is that if I make this window a little bit bigger, you'll see that once I created this group, worm mother cells, and then assigned some of these objects labels, now I've got a new column within my statistics table that shows me which objects and which tracks were labeled. And so this is great. I can, just like with any other column, I can go in and sort based on that column and then select these if I want to. It also means that not only is this information available within the table within Imaris, but when you export this data out into an Excel file or a CSV file, you'll also have that column and these labels there as well. So what I've shown you so far is an application for using labels, but in a situation where where I had already done some editing. You can also use this to just help you as you're going through and doing the editing, because you can turn on and off the visualization of your tracks. So I know of some people who are using this as a way of saying, okay, that track, it's perfect, I'm done with it, and they assign a label to it that says done, let's say. And then they make it, and then all of the other tracks have another label, and they just make sure that the tracks that they're working on are the only ones that they're visualizing. So it helps them with their editing and helps speed up that workflow for them. And that really is what is and was our goal for 9.2, to make sure that your workflow for working with spots and working with tracks is as fast as possible. Okay, let's see. Okay, so I really did save the best for last. So I'm gonna switch over to another image, last image, I promise. And for this image, we're going to look at surfaces really quickly. And in this case, I just need to change some colors. Okay, so this is an organoid image where you see sort of the main portion of it here that's circular. I've reconstructed it as surfaces, and then and I'm reconstructing the individual DAPI labeled nuclei. But you can also see that as part of this organoid, there's this other portion over here, sort of the top right. And if I rotate around a little bit, hopefully my internet is allowing you guys to see that this chunk over here is separate. So you can I can imagine a situation where someone might want to make that smaller so you can see a little bit more. But I can imagine a situation where someone might want to look at these two regions separately. And to do that, you would need to and after you've done your surface creation, you would need to somehow select all of these surfaces over here, these individual surfaces, to be able to sort of separate them or label them away from this main part. And in past versions of Imaris, the there was various ways of doing this, but sometimes it would come down to selecting individual surfaces. And so there are some clumps here, and so I can get a few, you know, some big clumps at a time, but you can see that this could be time-consuming and tedious. And what our development team came up with was a better way to select multiple objects at once. And so again, you need to be in the select mode, that's in the upper right-hand corner. And then instead of selecting pointer, you should select, first we'll go over the circle mode. And so when you click on circle, what you immediately see is that you have a nice circle that follows your cursor around. So I just clicked off into the black space so I could reset the selection. If I use my scroll wheel, I can make the circle bigger or smaller. And the way that it will do the selection is that at the rotation or orientation that I have the screen at now, it will select all the surfaces that fall within this circle. So I could probably make this a little bit bigger. And now I've clicked with the left mouse button and selected those, and I'm able to select all those surfaces at once. Now I can hold down Control and select some more, and so it's just adding to what I selected before. If you need to, you can make your circle smaller to get a little bit more detail. But I think I've done a pretty good job, and so in comparison to the time it would have taken if I was doing this all one by one, this is so much faster. And I think that almost everyone using Imaris will have a good use of this tool. And so we're really excited for this circle tool. We also have the box tool, so it's a little bit different. Instead of just selecting everything that's underneath that circle. So let me bring that circle up again. The circle works almost like a column. It goes through the entire depth of the image. The box doesn't do that. It is this 3D box that is used in other parts of Imaris. And what it can do is it's able to locate where the surface is that you're hovering over with your cursor. It's able to locate with that within the depth of the image. So you can see that if this one is, this surface right here is pretty close to the camera or to me, versus some of these are farther away, and the size of the box is changing as I move and hover, keep my and have my cursor over different surfaces. So this helps you select very specifically within the depth of the image. And so that's where that's when you would use box versus circle. We do think that circle is probably going to get used more often, but box has some special uses. Let's see. So that, again, is another place for having really fast having a really fast editing tool and improving the entire workflow within Imaris. So if I go back to the PowerPoint and we think again about what this goal was for us as we were planning out Imaris 9.2, it was that we were improving spots and tracking and making those such that your processing of very large files and the rendering of the results from those files was very fast and smooth. But we also wanted to make sure that when you're using spots and tracking, that the entire workflow is a lot faster and better for you. And so all of these improvements that we have made add up to significant time savings as you're working in the software. So I just want to end with some thanks for everyone that attended this webinar, so thank you for doing that. I also want to thank our development team who they came up with a lot of really fun and innovative solutions for the problems that we wanted to solve in this release. And I also want to thank our sales and support teams for giving feedback to make sure that what we made was as best as it could be, and to make sure that we found all those bugs during our beta testing. And then finally, I want to thank Anna, who makes all the pretty movies and images that you see on our website, and some of the stuff that I showed within the presentation today, and the marketing team as well. So with just to say one more time, with that multi-selection tool, you can make cute and cute images like this where you spell things out really easily. It didn't take Anna very long to do this. So hopefully everyone will have fun with that new tool. So thanks again for coming. And if you are interested in getting a demo version of this release, go ahead and go to Imaris.com where you can request a version or contact your local sales rep. We also have some video tutorials there, and you can learn more about the technology behind Imaris with some tech notes that we have.